Today I'm going to look at how the media discusses autism and neurodiversity through the lens of Herman and Chomsky's model of propaganda as published in Manufacturing Consent. Then I'll talk about what on earth is going on and what they do in propaganda about autism for. But first, if you're new here, I'm Mika and I make videos about philosophy, politics and neurodiversity. So subscribe and hit the bell if that's your jam too. And if you already know that you like my videos, then there is a link in the description where you can support the channel more directly through one-off donations. Cool, so propaganda and autism.
Part 1. Propaganda and fake news.
As long as there has been news, there has been fake news. Literally, we've been carving propaganda into rocks for thousands of years. As far back as recorded history goes, we have evidence of propaganda. Propaganda is considered to come in three forms, really creatively named: black, white, and grey. White propaganda usually contains accurate information or well-known sources, but is still used to shape ideology. Think of big sporting events, parades, or national holidays which are designed to instill a sense of patriotism among a population. Or the way politicians will say technically true things, but cherry-picked in a way that spins reality to suit them. Black propaganda is false, malicious, and deceptive information, sometimes attributed to unknown or non-existent authorities. This is probably what we would usually think of when we hear the word propaganda. And, as if you couldn't have guessed, grey propaganda lies somewhere in the middle, where the accuracy of the information or the validity of the sources is unknown. However, the purpose of spreading it is usually well known by those who are. I put quite a bit of the UK political commentary of the last election into this category. Remember Punchgate? How many times do we have to see? Sources say. Absolutely no further evidence or investigation. Fake news is similar to propaganda and the terms are often used interchangeably. However, fake news is rather a tool which propagandists use. For example, if I created a Twitter account exclusively for spreading rumours about the contestants of Love Island, it would be disinformation or fake news, but not really propaganda. Propaganda has been defined by Jowett and O'Donnell, the authors of Propaganda and Persuasion, as
the deliberate, systematic attempt to shape perceptions, manipulate cognitions, and direct behavior to achieve a response that furthers the desired intent of the propagandist.
Fake news, however, might be seen as merely bullshit, as was defined by philosopher Harry G. Frankfurt as
speech intended to persuade without regard for truth.
You might think that is in fact bullshit, but no. A philosopher did actually write a full-on essay theorising about what bullshit is. So you can see why I chose my degree subject. Critical knowledge right there. The difference between the two might still be unclear, so think of it this way. Propaganda doesn't always need to be false, just always biased and a means to a specific, usually political, end. Fake news is always false and only often biased. Now, the term fake news has certain specific connotations these days, and publishers all over the world are actually trying to stamp out its use. In 1988, Edward Herman and Noam Chomsky published Manufacturing Consent, in which they laid out their model of propaganda, which consisted of five filters: ownership, advertising, sourcing, flack, and fear.
Part 2. Ownership and advertising.
For today's purposes, I thought I'd group these two together as they both kind of speak to the profit motive inherent within most businesses and how this influences which audiences are seen to be most important. Chomsky and Herman described the fact that as media institutions or businesses, they're as incentivized as any other to achieve arbitrary growth goals. And this means that that will be their overriding priority. Should be noted here that profit might not be the overriding priority for some forms of media, which is a point regarding ownership. When we have billionaire owners of media, one of their publications not turning a profit really isn't going to bother them. But I'd say a lot of media still do want to make a profit, or at least need to be able to pay their staff. But a lot of media, I hope, isn't owned by billionaires yet. Media institutions' main and really only viable way to make any money is through advertising, meaning that the goals of the advertiser will take priority over the goals of the audience. Within marketing circles, it's widely accepted that mothers are the most exploitable market and are therefore the most advertised to. As a group, autistic people are unlikely to ever be the top earners in a society. Statistics show that we're much more likely to be unemployed or in precarious work. Even products which are designed for autistic people tend to be marketed towards parents and are modelled almost exclusively by children. Vans did a whole range of sensory footwear and clothing for Autism Awareness Month, of which one item came in adult sizes. Ugly shoes anyway. I mean, I probably would wear those rainbow ones though. Even the PR literature of institutions and charities intended to raise awareness of autism or to advocate for further rights or protections for autistic people tend to be aimed at a non-autistic audience. I know from experience when I was trying to research autism before my diagnosis that finding information about autistic adults is really hard. And the only information that I could find about being an adult while autistic was from the actually autistic vloggers, bloggers, and writers who are currently fighting with the media institutions I'm talking about, and who are way, way, way down the list of YouTube suggestions under a mountain of autism parent family vlogger things. Autistic people are not the target audience for the media being made about us. And that brings us nicely on to
part 3. Sourcing.
Chomsky and Herman said that the sources to which news and media turn tend to be limited, usually large-scale institutions, which have their own agenda. Even the largest of media institutions can't have reporters just everywhere that a story might break, so they tend to rely on government spokespeople or established bodies, as Chomsky wrote.
The mass media are drawn into a symbiotic relationship with powerful sources of information by economic necessity and reciprocity of interest.
One of the things that became clear to me when I was researching autism and neurodiversity is that there are so many actually neurodiverse creators, journalists, writers, and forthright activists who are fighting every single day to get their voices heard, to cut through the cacophony of voices who are speaking for them, fighting for that spot on the discussion panel on the lunchtime news. And it seems like a losing battle, at least as of yet. As individuals, neuroatypical people might have limitations which could prevent them from waging a consistent battle in the face of adversity. As a collective, I think we have more of a chance, but the community is still quite new and therefore, yeah, it can be messy. Things are better than they ever were, of course, but we still see things like National Geographic running a really long-awaited article on autistic adults, but it was written by a non-autistic writer who had published a really contentious book about her autistic son, which some autistic adults claimed was exploitative, offensive, and downright dangerous. When the criticisms of autistic adults were put to the author, she said that her book was not meant for an autistic audience. Char, I'm talking about you, not to you, so... Remember that last point about us never really being the target audience of the media made about us? Rather than getting on a regular autistic activist, media institutions are much more likely to turn to established charities such as Autism Speaks, or parents of autistic people with very high care needs, or celebrity charity spokespeople for their information about autism. Because why on earth would you want to ask an autistic person about autism? And that brings us nicely onto our next filter.
Part 4. FLAC.
As described by Chomsky and Herman, FLAC is the act of discrediting dissenting voices. They say that media and governmental institutions will work together to discredit these unwanted opinions and voices. A historical example of this can be seen in what was known as the Global Climate Coalition, which was made up exclusively of representatives from the oil, paper, and automotive industry who worked within Washington DC to lobby against any action to mitigate climate change and to discredit the science which backed it up. The sound science that backed it up. Or, more recently, we can look at the absolutely blanket, hive mind-like accusation of cultish behaviour within Labour as a way to delegitimise anyone who supported a democratic socialist as leader of the Democratic Socialist Party. By the way, I included 2 James O'Brien tweets in that because I just thought it was funny. That last one was referring to Traingate, in which Corbyn filmed himself sitting on the floor of a packed Virgin train and was like, nationalise trains because I'm sitting on the floor. And then Virgin released a video of the CCTV of the train, which supposedly showed that there were actually empty seats and he just walked past them for a PR stunt. And that's what Jobs' tweet was referring to. But then more footage was released which showed that the train was busy and that Virgin had used selective angles to make it seem empty and to make it seem like there weren't people actually in the, but there was like kids or like people sitting sort of crouching down, that kind of thing. Scandalous. Of course, that final revelation wasn't as well advertised as the previous one, although the BBC did actually pick that one up. I'm digressing. So, dissenting voices are delegitimised. What about autism though? Most people still lack an understanding of autism and neurodiversity in general. And it is true that in the minds of many, autistic people are seen as infantilized, unreasonable, unstable, and even dangerous. This can also be said for other neurotypes. Here's the Washington Post linking autism with serial killers. The study in question actually linked serial killers with childhood trauma, something which autistic people happen to be more likely to experience. Further studies confirmed that autistic people are way, way more likely to be the victim of a crime than the perpetrator of a crime. Well, this fact doesn't stop the commentators from pointing out the autism every time an autistic person does do a crime. Many autistic people feel as if they are being spoken over by advocate groups and charities, especially those who advocate for ABA-type interventions in early childhood to treat the autism, and who speak of autistic neurology as something that needs to be cured. And many of these groups just have ties to anti-vaxxers and just like not nice eugenicsy type people. There's a lot of talk of curing autism, but the reality of what that would look like due to the significant genetic nature of autism would be pre-birth screenings. So when you talk about a cure, you're not talking about curing existing autistic individuals. You're saying autistic people shouldn't be born. That's why autistic people get a bit upset. The Autism Self-Advocacy Network was set up to overcome the lack of actually autistic voices within autism advocacy circles.
Here is an Australian advocacy group who pushes ABA, dismissing the self-advocacy network as social justice warriors. On their website, one can find countless blog posts by a person called Bob
condemning neurodiversity, pushing for interventions, but also admitting to having had few close encounters with autistic people. By the way, while researching this video, I googled autism fake news and came across what looked like a study on how fake news affects autism policy. Perfect, thought I. Turned out to be a pure whinge about how everywhere outside North America are starting to turn their backs on ABA and how the ABA industry really doesn't like it.
And here is Autism Speak supporter William Shatner accusing autistic self-advocates of trying to divert funds away from those who need it and of being an exclusionary movement. In fact, my recent video on neurodiversity and leftist politics was posted onto the subreddit r/breadtube. Thank you very much for sharing it, by the way. But inevitably, the top comment ended up being a gish gallop of accusations against the neurodiversity movement as a whole, accusing it of inspiration porn and throwing those with higher care needs under the bus, as well as failing to pursue material changes which would benefit the lives of those for whom it advocates. This is a complete misrepresentation of a movement which makes more space for those with high care needs than any other community I've seen. It's one which always acknowledges the struggles and limitations of its members and is constantly pursuing corporate, societal, political changes to ease that suffering. In the same thread, the movement was on one hand accused of pseudoscientific practices such as self-diagnosis, and on the other hand, classism. Guys, the reason why the neurodiversity community accepts those who have self-diagnosed is because for millions of working class people, assessment and diagnosis is literally unobtainable. But while we do say that self-diagnosis is valid insofar as community acceptance goes, like you can come into our spaces, you can ask questions, you can ask for sources, you can reach out to people. On the other hand, it is always encouraged that people do seek an official diagnosis where possible. It's necessary if you are ever to need any assistance, any support, or any accommodations at all in an official capacity, and this is acknowledged. In fact, it is not only acknowledged, but there are several crowdfunding projects designed specifically to help with the financial costs of getting assessed and diagnosed. One of which was linked in the video you were commenting on. Also, it's worth saying that you might not agree with self-diagnosis, but that doesn't make it pseudoscience. I tell you what is though, behaviorism, which is the foundational wrong assumption behind all ABA practices. You can learn what's so wrong about it in my video. Motivation theory, behavior, and autism. Wherever there is a discussion of autistic self-advocacy or neurodiversity, you will see comments, sometimes even from autistic people themselves, raging against the fake autistics and the hijacking their cause. These attempts to segregate the autistic community along strict lines of outdated functioning labels is inherently exclusionary. As this blog post from a non-verbal autistic person with high care needs points out, there are few people better able to speak up for those with higher care needs than vocal autistic adults. By segregating the community into functioning types, these so-called activists dismiss one group as being unable to speak for themselves and condemning the other group for taking apparently finite attention away from the first group for daring to speak out. As well as the battle for advocacy, autistic is still used as a slur, albeit mainly among arseholes. The autistic screeching meme is still alive and well and thrown around, including at autistic people. And of course, this year we had TikTok users engage in a thankfully brief display of offensive twattery in the now banned Autism Challenge. Autistic people are known to be blunt. We don't hold much of a candle for social norms, what don't make sense to us. And sometimes this can result in our being misunderstood or coming across as rude or demanding. This is often just a part of our particular neurology, something which with great effort, we can sometimes mask over. Just for a second, let's consider other minorities. When black activists speak out against the violence done to them by the state, they are often dismissed as just overly angry, unnecessarily confrontational. Unless they adopt this overly polite demeanor, something which isn't expected of their white counterparts on the news discussion show. And frankly, even when they do, they are still talked over as if their very presence in the discussion is an inconvenience. Or how LGBTQAI plus people showing pride in their identities gets turned and twisted into a stereotype which is then used against them to delegitimize their voices. Now, when a minority group are simply less able to adopt this super, super polite professional media savviness, what chance have they got? So while it might not be this way completely across the board, autistic voices are being delegitimized in the way described by Herman and Chomsky. The fifth and final filter is fear.
Part 5. Fear.
This is the use of a supposed shared enemy to promote the established worldview. During the Cold War, when Herman and Chomsky were writing Manufacturing Consent, the shared enemy was communism. So this is the predominant example they use. But Chomsky has later argued that the war on terror and Islamophobia have since taken over. Of course, all kinds of groups have been used as the enemy over the years, and it's quite clear that it's not as if there's only ever one. Remember when it was single mums? When it comes to autism, as we've seen, publications do tend to like to link autism with unpredictable and therefore dangerous behaviour. But I want to talk about how autism itself is described. It's often spoken as a disease which has reached epidemic proportions. It's coming for your kids to ruin their lives and yours. Those who are touched by autism have lost a sense of themselves, a part of what makes them human. Who knows where it might strike next? Is it in the vaccines? Is it in the chemicals in the water? How to cure such a thing which transforms loving parents into would-be murderers? We must surely stop the spread. As we all know, people who have been touched by the autism have no empathy. And you know who else has no empathy? Psychopaths. I'm not here to argue that having yourself or your child diagnosed with a lifelong developmental condition isn't ever scary. I know it is. And I'm absolutely sure that coming to terms with the fact that your child might need significant care for the rest of their lives is absolutely terrifying, especially in today's society where those who need care aren't exactly treated great. And it is the perfectly legitimate fear of those parents which is being exploited by the types of language I have described. And this fear is exacerbated, leading to parents perhaps unwittingly engaging in movements and measures which could be extremely harmful to their children and other autistic people. Look up bleach as a treatment for autism. But hold on, I can hear you all exclaim. Why on earth would anyone want to propagandize against autistic people in the neurodiversity movement? The concept of neurodiversity threatens some very ingrained assumptions about human nature. Namely, that there is one. There's a cat in here now. Hey! Whether you believe we are that way through design or evolution, the idea that there is a one nature, which all humans are, is extremely widely held. Now, in academic or philosophy circles, making arguments from human nature is always risky business. An argument from human nature is like, we should do X, because human nature. And it would usually get you rejected from any serious academic discussion. But in the general discourse, in media and in publications, it's human nature is something you'll probably hear quite a lot. Competitiveness is human nature, greed is human nature, selfishness, fearing the other is human nature. Our economic systems and the institutions which support them were designed, hey, by people who held quite essentialist views of human nature. And the arguments for their continuation also rest on essentialist views. People won't work for free. People will become lazy if given handouts. War is merely a consequence of human nature. I talk more about why the very concept of neurodiversity is a danger for the essentialist views of human nature which uphold capitalism in my video on leftist politics and neurodiversity. It's linked in the description, so I recommend you go and watch that after this one if you haven't already. So today we have learned about how Chomsky and Herman modelled propaganda and how this model can be applied to coverage of autism and neurodiversity. I hope you either learned something today or at least gained some validation that yes, coverage of neurodiversity really is that bad. If you enjoyed that video, please click on the like button. If you really enjoyed that video, please click on the subscribe button. And if you really, really enjoyed the video, then please consider having a look at my Ko-fi account, which is linked below. Come follow me on things if you're not already. Instagram these days be full of this one. Ain't that right? And I will see you next time.
You've been sleeping all day.
Sleepy kitten.
Oh, she's sleeping. Tick, tick, tick.